It's the end of an era, the final four-wheel drive round bringing to a close a spectacular chapter in the Australian Rally Championship. The two and four-wheel drive titles have already been decided for 2012, so the final round for the season is somewhat of a preview of the year ahead, a year when two-wheel drives will be the National Rally Championship. Welcome to Rally Victoria, a season finale with a difference. In our show today, as well as highlighting the champions for 2012 in both two and four-wheel drive, we'll see how the rallyschool.com.au Junior Challenge winners fare in their fully funded drive, and sneak a peek at some of the two-wheel drive cars coming our way next season. The East Coast Bull Bars SUV Challenge has paved the way for four-wheel drive competition in the future, and we'll catch up with Brett Middleton in the Subaru Forester. We'll also showcase a couple of new classics to the Bosch ARC, chasing down series leader Neil Bates. In championship terms, Michael Bowden and Helen Cheers are unable to be beaten in the four-wheel drive series, with Tom Wilde and Nick Box retreating to prepare for their own two-wheel drive assaults next year. Mick Patton picks up second spot overall, having already won the Premier League. In a classic tortoise and hare scenario, Brett Middleton sneaks into the fastest five in the East Coast Bull Bars SUV. So, the Warhope Warrior has a different approach to this final round.
The pressure's off, like we're in just relaxed mode. We're even going out with second-hand tyres on the back to start, so like that's how cool and cucumber we are. But looking forward to it. It's going to be very slippery, but I really don't care if I come 15th now. Like I've got the major prize that we were after for this year, and then we're looking to bigger and better things for next year.
The two-wheel drive championship is all Honda. Eli Evans and Glenn Weston, too strong and reliable for the competition. Teammate Mark Pedder has been unable to match his pace or reliability this year, and with Jack Monkhouse's big crash in Coffs Harbour, Alan Rowe and Matt Amos are left to fight it out for third. Defending his new title will be a much harder proposition next year, so Eli Evans will not be letting up this weekend.
I want to get out there and keep that smile off Simon's face as much as I can, because he was going pretty quick at the last round in Coffs Harbour and I didn't really like it too much, so we've got a few tricks up our sleeve here and see what happens. We're just going to push as hard as we can and get little Honda Jazz through the forest.
The final of the rallyschool.com.au Junior Challenge brought the best two- and four-wheel drive competitors to the top of a great group of up-and-coming rally aspirants. Dane Berry won four-wheel drive and will drive his own Evo 4, funded by Kumo Tyres and rallyschool.com.au. His aspirations for this weekend, very simple.
Go and enjoy the car for one last time, see how we go and see if we can get a good placing.
Two-wheel drive winner Adam Kasmiri picks up a funded drive in a rallyschool.com.au Evo 4 and is looking forward to showing just what he's capable of.
So it's sort of a works drive for me, so something you're not used to. You don't know the feeling of driving someone else's car at speed, and I just sort of take care of it a bit more and look forward to it.
Kasmiri's round didn't start well, crashing the Evans Mazda 2 while betting in brakes in testing 3 days ago. Frantic efforts by the crew sees the new G2 spec Mazda race ready, but there are some bleary eyes in the paddock.
Came out of the panel shop at about 11 o'clock and we pressed on all through the hours in the morning and took it for a drive at 6 o'clock this morning. So none of the boys have had any sleep, neither have I, so it's going to be a hard weekend. I feel really bad for what I did, because Mick gave me the opportunity just to test the car, and it just happened so quickly, it didn't feel real.
For the man set to race the Mazda 2, it's not the start to the weekend he wanted.
It's definitely a first in my rallying career to turn up the testing and someone else has already rolled your car for you. So, yeah, it was a bit of a shock. But look, these things are made to test us, and the boys have done a fantastic job. They've had to work through the night and repair the car, and I'll never give up attitude. So the little Mazda is pretty tough, and we'll go out there and we'll do the best we can.
Evans is not the only one set to challenge the Honda supremacy next season. Current Australian Rally champion Justin Dowell will return with a South African-built G2 spec Volkswagen Polo Mark IV, and it will debut this weekend, but he has nothing to prove.
I'm just here to learn. You know, after being in a car with Simon, I see how fast they've got to be driven, and you know, so you got to start from the bottom and work your way up again. And you know, Mark, he's had a tough year doing the same sort of thing. So our plan is to do this event, and we want to get about 1,000 k's testing over the summer break, and hopefully be on the money by Canberra.
Dowell will not be the only driver in a polo next season. His teammate, the newest Australian Rally champion.
Having Michael in, because we get along so well, you know, it's going to be good, you know, and it gives our sponsors more coverage and all those sort of things too, and he'll have his own car sponsors and so on, of course, but you know, it's all about sharing logistics and resources and helping each other out.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to it. It's going to be exciting, something different. It's going to be a challenge, but yeah, I think there's going to be a variety of different cars next year, and it should be really good for the championship.
It's going to be really hard. I think next year the top 10 and so on, it's not like it's going to be, it used to be. It's no one's going to be able to predict anything. And from a spectacle point of view, you're going to have such a different variety of cars and manufacturers involved. It's going to be, you know, really lift the championship to a new level.
Next year's juniors will also have a series, and this will be fought out with Ford Fiestas.
The R2 class is limited to 1600cc, and it's very much the same to our production rally car rules here in Australia, so there's a lot of production car parts on this. Has a sequential gearbox and big brakes and really good Ryga suspension, so I mean they're the good parts of the package, so yeah, hopefully it's competitive.
Stephen Turner grabbed the opportunity to steal a march and imported a UK-prepared Fiesta R2 to gain valuable experience on the road before the new season begins. So some familiar faces returning to the rally scene in preparation for next year, and some new cars joining the fray for the final round of the Bosch Australian Rally Championship for 2012. All that action coming up shortly. Competition for the final round of the Bosch Australian Championship in Victoria is spread over 2 days in East Gippsland. Heat one begins between Neerham and Powelltown and uses two stages that will be repeated before teams return to Lardner Park near Warrigal for the super special stages. Eli Evans is first two-wheel drive away, the championship Honda setting the pace across the 14 kilometres.
Short left 8. Then short left 7, short 8, 50.
Amazingly, despite its roll less than 36 hours earlier, the Mazda 2 is 1.8 seconds quicker in the hands of brother Simon. Justin Dowell's start is a wake-up call when a drive shaft breaks. And co-driver Scott Spedding are fine, but it's a sharp reminder about just what can happen when you least expect it.
Yeah, it just broke. And I straightened at about 140k an hour and just chewed us up and spat us out into the banks, unfortunately. But it's a bit of a hairy ride, a bit of a baptism of fire to two-wheel drive, but it's part of rallying, part of the fun, at least we didn't roll.
Through Adder River, the big rocks lodged in the road's surface have been painted white in the hope they'll be easier to miss. Amos guides the heavy V8 ute around most of them, but hits one, damaging the left front suspension tower. Still, he is only 4 seconds off third fastest, Mark Petter. Alan Rowe's Repco Nissan 200SX is fifth after SS1, just ahead of young Steve McKenzie in the Ford Fiesta. The Honda leads off through SS2. Pioneer Creek Road winds its way for 21 kilometres from the main Yarra Junction Nuji Road up into the forest and back to the main road.
Got a flat, care, short right, 7 loose. Hey, spectator points up here.
Eli and Glenn's chances of a heat win take a turn. Simon and Sue power through to win SS2 Pioneer by 22 seconds.
Left long, 150.
But they nearly don't when the fuel pressure drops near the end of stage.
3 long, 100. Are you serious?
No fuel pressure.
Mark Petter is next two-wheel drive home, but his and Claire Ryan's is a wild ride in the other Honda Jazz. The Repco Nissan is third home, but Alan Rowe is being chased down by Stephen Turner in the Fiesta R2, who finishes 5 seconds behind. In the transport, between the first two stages, Turner adjusts the damper in the suspension to stop the car understeering. The other Fiesta doesn't fare so well.
There's a little bit of a bump on the side road up there, and we've come in well too much committed and off in to the ditch here and fell over.
But yeah. No damage by the look.
No damage, so I think we're out of late running time, so tomorrow we'll be back out there and be off again.
You might be able to still get in the rally still.
4 minutes, yep. We're over.
After service in Nerham, teams return to Adder River. No surprise to see the Mazda again lead through three. Simon Evans showing the mastery that brought him to the top of the game in two-wheel drives many years ago before stepping into a four-wheel drive. Eli is only 3 seconds behind, but the early signs of just what we can expect next season are beginning to be seen. The fight for stage fourth between Rowe and Amos ends when the Nissan is sidelined with a flat.
Got a flat. Got a flat, right?
Got a flat.
Yeah, right.
Amos slides the SS Ute home 3 seconds in front of Stephen Turner. Justin Dowell is more conservative in his approach to the repeat runs. The recently imported Polo came with plenty of spares, but gauging the usable life left in some of the components has left the team less than confident.
Learning, you know, obviously the weak links in the car and getting them strengthened, but it's just one of those things. We didn't know the age of the drivetrain in it, so we just thought we'll wing it and see how we go.
Managing component wear is a critical part of any team's success. Knowing just when a drive shaft should be replaced at a certain point in the competitive life of the car means the difference between winning and losing. For Justin, the shift from a product he knows so well to the unknown means starting that process all over.
Slight press, then caution, brake 30, right 3.
Flat tyre aside, Eli has not been able to take the stage off his brother.
50, far short left 6.
So that's a really, really tricky stage. There's a lot of downhill sections. It's about, I reckon it's about 8K, continuous downhill. Your concentration just, it's off the planet, and you're just holding on. It's quite a physical thing to hang on to this little front wheel drive down the hill, and I tell you what, you've got to be fit. I've got to keep working on my fitness, that's for sure.
If Eli thought he had a fitness problem, spare a thought for his brother Simon in the Mazda G2.
You are up by 6. Fast right 3.5, long late, slippy. Keep it up, you're doing awesome.
The power steering has failed completely and Evans has been manhandling the front wheel drive without the benefit of power assistance.
I was working my butt off in there. Look, I just kept my focus and just tried to keep it as clean as possible and work to the car's strengths, which is his acceleration. Yep. This thing's amazing. But trying to turn it at the moment, wow, I haven't worked that hard. That's good. I love this stuff.
Eli hits back through the super special at Lardner Park, winning the stage from Steve McKenzie, an amazing performance in his Ford Fiesta. The junior just 0.3 behind the Honda, but beating the derived time given to Simon Evans for SS5. Through the repeat of the Lardner Park stages, Matt Amos gives away third place in the heat to Stephen Turner, whose front-wheel drive is better suited to the slippery surface and tight corners of the super special conditions. He moves up a place to second in the heat in his debut of the new Fiesta when a fuel issue robs Simon and Sue Evans of their first heat victory in the Mazda.
We were transporting back from the forest and ran out of fuel, so it's interesting because obviously we're running a standard Mazda 2 tank and it only carries 38 litres. We left the refuel with it full to the brim, but just didn't quite have enough to get back.
Their demise means celebration for Mark Petter and Claire Ryan. The second Honda team scores its first win for the season after a consistent run through the afternoon.
We wanted to take out second in the championship, so we were driving fairly conservatively and the times were still not bad, but had I said at the start of the year that would be a 1-2 would be, you know, a dream come true. So it has come true, which is just sensational for the team, sensational for Honda.
Up next, the four-wheel drive action from Rally Victoria.
final round of any championship brings with it changes in teams, but the shift from four to two-wheel drive leaves many in the paddock looking to just what 2013 will bring. Will Orders won the Junior Challenge here a year ago and got the opportunity to compete in America. Now he's home, he joins a throng of drivers eager to show what they can do.
We had the opportunity to drive this, the Evo 5, and our cars sort of only just got back from America, so they weren't quite ready, so we'll take any opportunity we can to drive a rally car.
Orders and fiancé Lauren Gray waste little time showing the four-wheel drive field who's boss, clearing out across SS1 by more than a second a kilometre. Bowden and Cheers are next, but obviously not chasing down Orders. Bowden's decision to run second-hand Kumos might have been debatable, but he's still 3 seconds ahead of John Mitchell and Joe Cadman. Matt Van Tunen is well in touch with Mitchell in his Group N STI Impreza. In Coffs, he showed good pace, and again the Queenslander starts inside the fastest five.
And seven right, Titans five.
Mick Patton driving an ARC spec version of the same car is 10 seconds behind.
Power. 50.
But in front of both the juniors.
Seven long, just reset.
Dane Berry is the quickest in the direct brakes entry, but well off the lead pace of Orders. Adam Kasmiri, on the other hand, has a considered approach to rallying a borrowed car. After his start to this round, he wasn't about to tip over a second rallyschool.com.au car. Victorian Wayne Stewart steps up to the ARC for this round and immediately finds himself in the thick of the action. This should have been a good round for Stewart, lying second in the Victorian Championship, but a broken output shaft in the gearbox puts pay to that and his ARC aspirations.
20 right, 4.5.
Regular ARC competitor Bruce Fullerton has a moment in the Alliance Airlines Mitsubishi, but is able to keep going. The bent control arm will be fixed in service, but tight corners are a huge issue in the meantime.
Go.
Derek Reynolds' assault on Victoria in the Newman's Petroleum Mitsubishi runs out of drive early.
Is that just broken gearbox? Nothing?
Broke something.
Matt Lee, start to his first ARC event as a driver, lasts longer, but not much. 4 kilometres from the start, his Celica's driveline fails. Returning to the co-driver's seat with Justin Dow next season will hopefully bring better results. After his two-wheel excursion into the scenery last round, Brett Middleton will be looking to use all wheels this event.
Yeah, I think so. Although some of the stages are pretty fast, there's a little bit of opportunity for some commitment there and testing the limits of adhesion, don't you think?
Middleton runs top 10 in the family spec SUV and has committed to the East Coast Bull Bars SUV Challenge again in 2013. Dane Berry is third through SS2, ahead of the four-wheel drives of Van Tunen and Mitchell. For the Fibertech medical crew, the issue is the balance between front and rear brakes.
Oh, too much bias. Left 3.5 on crest. So too much bias.
The Repco STI of Mick Patton suffers electronic gremlins en route to SS2, and the trip meter, speedo and windows all fail to work.
Just got to drive it on the torque upper gear, but don't chuck it anywhere because we've got no power.
Something in the ECU is limiting the engine revs. They make the finish and lock in second outright in the championship, but at best, they are 3 minutes off the pace and languishing with the wooden spoon for the remainder of the heat. The repeat of Adder River brings the same result for the top four, but all are 10 seconds quicker. Without a spin, Bowden closes the gap to just five. The only bodywork Brett Middleton has damaged on the Forester this year is the wing mirror in South Australia. As you'd expect, with good rally tradition, it was on the co-driver's side, not his own. And today's no different.
Oh, you okay?
Yeah, I'm fine.
The broken glass doesn't affect Andrew Benefield, and they finish the stage a second quicker than the first pass. The final stage in the Forest brings a repeat of the first three positions again. Orders one, Bowden second, with Dane Berry third, leaving the Junior Challenge winner in fifth outright. And in line with his objectives, the other junior winner, Adam Kazmiri, improves his speed, bringing the Fibertech-sponsored rally school entry home in sixth in stage and sixth outright. The man at the moment, though, is the 2011 Junior Challenge winner, who's done enough to secure his first heat win in an ARC event.
I certainly have done enough. 30-second win, so good day at the office.
Simon Knowles had been having a good day at the office as well, until the super special stage. Fortunately for Simon and wife Margot, the damage is superficial, and with service next up, they won't lose much time. Michael Bowden dominates the super special stage at Lardner Park. It won't change the result of the heat win. Order's lead gives him that accolade. But the juniors, Kazmiri and Berry, show their form, coming home second, respectively, behind the new Aussie champ in the last two stages of Heat 1. Heat 2 is coming up shortly, but next, our resident rally expert, Ross Dunkerton, talks rally safety. And we check out the classics from Rally Victoria.
Now, driving special stages in the Bosch Australian Rally Championship at high speed takes skill and concentration because there are no off-roads, there's no sand traps for those that make a mistake. But sadly, some of us do. So how do the teams get away practically unscathed after a big visit into the scenery? Well, it's all to do with the strict rules and regulations that cars and crews go through before they start every rally. Teams of scrutineers check every competing car for roadworthiness and that their rollover protection complies with the CAM's regulations. They also check seats, seat belts, fire extinguishers and safety gear. And that's just a few of the many things that are checked. Then it's on to the crews themselves. They have to wear fire retardant driving suits, which includes fire retardant underwear, socks and even shoes. Like their apparel, helmets must be checked for age and damage. And then there is the hands device, now being used by more and more crews, even in small club rallies. Now these prevent neck injuries from holding the head from moving too far forward in a big crash. On the stages, there are radio points to check the cars as they fly past. And then there is the rally safe, a satellite device which tracks every competing car, and with safety crews waiting at every stage, all bases are covered. Now just think about it. If we had all that safety gear in our daily car, there would be a lot less road fatalities. But on the other hand, I don't think Mother would don a driving suit and a helmet just to go to the shops.
The resurgence of classic cars in rallying worldwide has been astounding. The Silver Fern Marathon Rally, held in New Zealand at the same time as this round, attracted 50 cars from Australia, New Zealand, the USA and Europe, including 24 Ford Escorts, testing themselves over 1,000 kilometres of special stages. Little wonder then numbers were down for the final appearance of the classics in Victoria. But still, new cars came out of the woodwork to challenge the supremacy of Neil Bates in his Celica. Fellow ACT competitor Trevor Stilling joined the round with Cole Trinder pointing the way. And Kim Beaglehole stepped up to the ARC from the Victorian Club Series and has noticed the difference running at the front of the field.
Well, yeah, that is a difference. And the organisation, the officials and pace notes. My goodness me, pace notes are a whole different kettle of fish.
One of the mainstays of classic rallying in Australia returned for his home round, Darren Snooks, finally getting his Datsun Stanza back on the road after an engine failure in the Alpine Rally last year.
Oh yes, finally we got ourselves back together and we're here.
Enjoying it? You going to have fun this weekend?
Yeah, look, we're looking forward to it. We just want to get to the finish today.
Snooks and co-driver Michael Forshew did make the finish, but not before being sidelined with front brake issues early in Heat 1. Neil Bates held off a determined charge from Grant Walker, the RS 1800 expert from Victoria, but he wasn't able to match the horsepower and skill of the multiple Australian champion.
I know on the first stage this morning I had a smile on my face and I actually said to myself, "Ooh, you better concentrate here, I was just enjoying it so much." So there's no pressure, and I know Neil says that, you know, whether we finish first or fifth, it doesn't really matter, so, and I'm the same.
But things don't go all Bates' way. In Heat 2, he and Coral Taylor are sidelined.
What? No gears.
It's broken the bottom off the gear stick, so we'll go back to service now and just see if we can fix that. But, yeah, annoying. I was having fun. There's such fantastic roads and, you know, very, very slippery, but having an absolute ball, it was... I don't think I've ever been so sideways.
Grant Walker was left to head the classic charge for the remainder of the heat from Darren Snooks, who rejoined and diced with Stilling for second, but settled for fourth for the weekend behind the Victorian, with Bates finishing behind the event winner, Grant Walker. Coincidentally, Walker provided the daily double. His BDA, built by Palmside Automotive, was the sister car to the winner of the Silver Fern Marathon Rally on the same day across the Tasman. After the break, it's back to the future. The final chapter in a long association of four-wheel drives comes to an end for the Bosch Australian Rally Championship. Heat 2 of Rally Victoria is spread further afield around East Gippsland, but using similar territory to previous events. The first part of Benny's Up is the same as last year's stage, but runs left onto McCarthy Spur Road, heading north for a further 10 kilometres, extending the new stage to almost 24 in total. Will Orders sets the morning pace through SS7, but John Mitchell never makes the spectator point.
Go, 30, right 2.5 over brow, 20, right 3.5, continues on brow. Oh, son of a bitch!
Sorry, babe.
We're out.
We're out, all right.
With Mitchell and Cadman out, Matt Van Tunen's chances of a heat podium increase. But tyre grip is an issue for him also.
150.
Sorry.
It's Adam Kazmiri's moment in the sun after a conservative start in Heat 1 off the back of rolling the Mazda 2 pre-event. Kazmiri, with Sam Hill pointing the way, comes home second ahead of Michael Bowden. Derek Reynolds gets a better start to Heat 2. He and Victorian Warren Lee will dice for sixth through the morning stages. Van Tunen beats Berry back into fifth through SS8. New Turkey is new for 2012, shortened by 9 kilometres to 14k, but travelling in the same direction. The fastest car, Summit Racing, covers the distance in 9 minutes 50 seconds. Orders is showing good form at a time when the chance of getting a drive in 2013 is front and centre.
You know, we'd love to be a part of the action, obviously in a two-wheel drive car, so... We'll see what perspires. It's that time of year. It's a bit crazy and busy and deals going on everywhere, so hopefully we can put something together and be in a car for 2013.
Simon and Margot Knowles have returned for the final round to wrap up their ARC competition for 2012.
We're currently leading the International Cup in Group N, so we thought we'd come back for the last round and give it a good hit.
Unlike most of the ARC field, the Knowles have four-wheel drive plans afoot for next season.
Planning on doing Pacific Cup, which is New Zealand, New Caledonia, Queensland, and then we'll do the world round at Coffs Harbour as well.
Short right left.
Mick Patton has almost ticked all the boxes, a win in Premier League and second outright for the championship. But the Repco STI still has a niggling electronic issue that is slowing the last challenge. Finishing Heat 2 will allow co-driver Bernie Webb to collect second outright as well. The experts have come up with a fix. Wiring the ECU directly to the right-hand indicator should work.
We're wiring it into the right-hand indicator at the moment,
yep.
Which is telling the computer that we've got a little bit of signal going to the speedo, and it's telling it that we're moving. And once we're moving, it lets everything else work. But the problem with that is if the indicator cancels halfway through a corner, I go back to having quarter throttle again. So very unnerving in the car. But we're also wiring up a little hockey strap on the indicator,
yep.
So hopefully that stays down enough and doesn't get in the road of my feet.
The temporary fix helps. Patton and Webb move up three places through Bunyip Reverse. Michael Bowden closes the gap on Adam Kazmiri, the junior's lead reduced to just half a second by the end of stage. Warren Lee's effort to maintain contact with the juniors takes a backward step when the intercooler hose blows off in the Bridgestone Mitsubishi through SS10.
They're an annoyance. It's like a mosquito biting at me.
We can't nail them. They're very, very good. Yeah. And but hey, you know, we'll shake it up. We've still got half the day to go. Yeah.
Bowden snatches 7 seconds from Adam Kazmiri and with it, second outright in the heat.
I actually backed off on the last stage to sort of try and preserve the tyres because I've only got four left because of the aggressive roads here in the hot temperature. It's worn them out a bit, so I've got two new ones on the front now and running the second hands at the rear, so I'll try a bit harder and try and catch Bowden in the next couple.
Like every other year at Rally Victoria, there has been a high wear rate on the tyres. Mm. The temperatures this year are about 8 to 10 degrees cooler than they were last year. Mm-hmm. So the difference really this year is they're still going out on the medium compound tyres to get the better grip levels, but experiencing high wear rates. Whereas last year they went out on the hard compounds and got the same wear rates because of the higher daily temperatures. What we're finding this year is with their tyre allocation, they're managing to complete the event even using the softer medium compound tyres.
Back in service, John Mitchell reflects on what might have been today after crashing in the first stage this morning.
As soon as I come over the crest, I just seen how slippery the blue metal was, and I was probably a bit wide, braked a bit late, and next thing I knew, we're going off the road sideways, but there was about a 30-foot drop down a deep embankment to where we ended up.
Five.
If the Fibertech medical driver was disappointed for his sponsor's sake, he needn't be. Gerald Schofield was already lining up for a repeat of the very same stage Benny's up. Conscious, he shouldn't do what he remembered two team cars did once before.
Whoa! Oh,
what did I say?
Yeah, there was a time a few years ago on a Victorian rally where, shall I say, a Petters crew put two cars off exactly the same spot, and I've been thinking about that ever since John put his off this morning. And I've done the same thing.
The seesaw battle between junior Dane Berry and Matt Van Tumen continues. Berry took five out of the Queenslander to snatch fourth outright through SS10, only to have the Queenslander grab three back next stage. By the end of SS12, Van Tumen takes another second to be just one behind Berry in outright time.
It's been a good battle all day, and you know, he obviously is a local, he knows the roads, and we've been at the front of the field sweeping.
With just two forest stages remaining, the fight for fourth is hotting up.
Five left, and then a right entry, four and a half left. Don't cut.
It's a fait accompli for Michael Bowden. With nothing more to gain for the year, he and sister Helen Cheers are enjoying their end of season, even if tyre management is still high on the agenda.
We're still setting some reasonable times now that the road's starting to clear. But she's been a tyre chewer, that's for sure, this event. So we've actually had to strategy your tyres, and we're up to our 16th now, so that's it. We're going out on our 16th tyres.
If there is a moving stage in Rally Victoria, it's SS13, the repeat of Bunyip Reverse.
I'm all right. You all right?
You okay?
Yes.
It's a clean run for Dane Berry in the Brakes Direct Evo 4. Confident, the sight of Van Tunen and Aaron Kelly means they've consolidated fourth. Kazmiri is next, but the junior, who has reclaimed so much ground this weekend to be third outright in Heat 2, comes unstuck, clipping a rock just 300 metres from Van Tunen. Bruce Fullerton picks up his best placings for the weekend as a result, 6th through SS13 and 5th through the final forest stage, Tarago Reverse. The Alliance Airlines Evo 9 might well have fared even better had a refuelling issue at the start of Heat 2 not forced them to back off, with low-octane fuel threatening to detonate the engine. No such problem for the Newman Petroleum entry. After being sidelined in Heat 1, Reynolds and Baker bounce back to be fourth by the end of the second heat. The Warhope Warrior caps off a stellar year by winning the final forest stage from Will Orders. Summit Racing may well have won both heats and Rally Victoria for 2013. The season accolades go to Michael Bowden and Helen Cheers. Mick Patton and Bernie Webb both collect second for the season, as well as first in Premier League. Remarkably, Tom Wilde's great start to the year sees him maintain third outright, while Brett Middleton leapfrogs Nick Box to claim fourth. So Michael Bowden and Helen Cheers are the last to have their names etched in the Possum-Born Trophy as four-wheel drive Australian Rally Champions. Next year, it's all two-wheel drive,
And there's more of that coming up next in the Bosch Australian Rally Championship from Rally Victoria. With both championships decided and four-wheel drive behind us, the two-wheel drive fight involved some family pride. It was Evans versus Evans. Eli finally getting his name on the trophy that had been Simon's four times already. With Big Brother about to re-enter the competition full-time next year, this weekend is being watched by everyone. Despite the roll 2 days before, Simon had gathered up the Mazda and, but for lack of fuel on a transport stage, it almost carried the rallyschool.com.au entry to victory in Heat 1. That only upped the ante, and Evans Senior set out to show Evans Junior just who was boss in Heat 2. Yes, there were others in the competition, but for the first two stages, the focus was squarely on the muscling between Honda and Mazda. SS7, Benny's up, is 23.75 kilometres and Simon covers the ground in 15 minutes, 24 seconds. Eli is 12 seconds slower in the Honda and on notice about his competition.
50, fast right 8, links fast 6.
Things get worse for Eli through New Turkey. This time, over the shorter 15-kilometre stage, his brother takes close to a second a K off his best time. Steve McKenzie is showing good form too. He and younger brother Brent are only five behind Eli and, importantly, ahead of Pedder and Ryan in the other Honda. The one-sided fight continues into SS9, Bunyip Reverse, with Simon pushing the Mazda to the limit.
Caution, fast left 3 long.
The family duel is over, with the Honda now firmly in front. McKenzie finishes 8 behind Eli, proving his previous stage times are no fluke. Mark Pedder is next, but the Polo of Justin Dowell is less than 2 seconds behind, despite Dowell requiring an almost unnaturally conservative approach to his rally.
Basically, because we've got the drive shaft issues and so on, all the tight stuff, I have to ease off the throttle, keep the revs down because I don't want to break another shaft. We want to get through the rest of the day. So pretty much that's how we're doing it for all the tight stuff.
Stephen Turner struggles through the morning stages with bad tyre choice. The thought had been to use the R900 for the wider open roads, but he underestimates the slippery surface and drops down the order after rocks jam the rear brakes and spin him off the road.
Oh yeah, we're running fantastically, but we've lost a lot of time now, so be it.
Matt Amos has had to devise a new driving style in the V8 Ute.
Something we found actually on this morning stages was there's a swept line which is really grippy, and then offline is obviously a lot of rocks. The problem with our car is it has a long wheelbase, so the front wheels are on the swept line, but the back is actually a little bit further out, so it is quite tricky. And yeah, we've had to change the driving style even on the stages today. We started trying to do a Scandinavian flick to turn it in, but we just couldn't stop it then because the rear tyres started hanging out and all the loose stuff. So we're really changing the driving style to keep it nice and conservative and clean and almost like a front wheel drive line, and just keep it nice and tight on the apexes and then accelerate out as hard as we can.
A flat tyre in SS11 blows his chances, but then the engine overheats as well, and a 7-minute penalty makes the fight for third in the championship the closest. Alan Rowe needs a break like this to keep his championship podium chances alive, but New Turkey is the decider.
5 left long, immediate 4 right. Something's happened. Gearbox.
They might not have fourth gear.
5 left.
But after a frustrating season, Rowe and Ray Farrell still have their sense of humour. The task now is to get to the finish as best they can.
Short 9 right into 3 left and 5 left.
Justin Dowell makes his presence felt through the repeat of Bunyip Reverse. He and Scott Spedding are second to the Honda, showing just what the future of two-wheel drive will be. Through SS14 Tarago, Alan Rowe beats Matt Amos despite nursing the Nissan through the 18 kilometres. But even a third in the super special to finish the event is not enough to rest a championship third, Amos, by the smallest of margins for the podium position in 2012. Mark Petter has spent the year coming to terms with the two-wheel drive in a bid to get a head start on the 2013 season. With a 1-2 for Honda, almost everything's fallen into place. A round win is on the cards with a finish of third or better in the last stage, Tarago reverse. But like Simon Evans' fuel issue in Heat 1, there is often a sting in the tail. With a conservative drive to bag third place required, what he and Claire Ryan have failed to realise is the final forest stage of the event is deemed a power stage. Nothing different about the stage itself from the first pass, only bonus points are on offer for the first three cars home, and that will affect the weekend result. In fact, with Eli winning the stage, the sister Jazz needs second to edge his teammate out of their first round win. The elation of a heat win and second in the championship confirmed yesterday is tempered with the knowledge they were so close to a round victory. Did they back off by 10 seconds or more? Who knows? The result? A record 6 straight round wins for the Honda Jazz of Eli Evans and Glenn Weston.
Like, that's twice this year. It just shows, never give up. We lose 4 minutes day one. We look down and out and we just stuck with it. Kept our heads clear, kept driving, and we end up getting the win again.
In championship terms, Eli and Glenn Weston are on top, with Mark Petter and Claire Ryan making the Honda double. Matt Amos sneaks in ahead of first privateer Alan Rowe. But all that changes next year when more teams return in a vastly expanded field to see just who is the fastest man on gravel in the new East Coast Bull Bars Australian Rally Championship. We look forward to catching you at the Capital Rally in Canberra come March the 1st. We'll see you then.
Yeah, bring on 2013. A lot more cars and a lot more competition. Oh, I can't wait. It's going to be fantastic.